Nobody really knows where it begins or where it ends. It runs for miles from Birmingham to Wolverhampton, from Wolverhampton to Stourbridge. It includes the towns like West Bromwich, Darlaston, Willenhall, Dudley, Cradleheath, Raleigh Hill, Dalloy. They're all black country towns. It's called black right because from the time of the Industrial Revolution, when they discovered fire clay and coal and iron and processed it, there were literally thousands of stacks pouring out raw black smoke. And over the population of 2.25 million contained in the 100 square miles of the black country. It's not beautiful. It's got character all its own. Some people would say it's depressing, but it's real. It's purposeful. It's honest. In the street where I was born, we were all very clannish. Mother, father, a sister, a brother, another sister, all lived in 5 houses. Up the road was the school I attended. Down the road, the Bethel Chapel, where I was sent to Sunday school. And believe me, nothing seems to have changed over all the 50-odd years that I've known this area. Of course, it really began with the discovery of coal and fire clay and iron. At one time of day, there were literally hundreds of small coal pits scattered right throughout the area. But today, so few are the mines that we actually have to import much coal and similar things into the area. Of course, fire clay is a basic mineral. And without fire clay, we should not have had iron and steel industries as we know them. You can get coal, you can have iron. But before you can melt iron, you must have a fire clay or refractory lining for the vessels in which you melt. Because if you try to melt iron in an iron vessel, the vessel itself would melt before the iron it contained. Over the years, fire clay has been important to industry. It's been mined in South Staffordshire in the Black Country for a considerable time, and it is still mined, and it's still important, so much so that the refractory goods from this area are worldwide in their use and their reputation. Having discovered and produced iron, it was natural that they would process it. And in 1001 ways, we did just that. Small shops made nails and chain pipe hooks and the like. But right throughout the district, we did iron formation in some way, very often specialized. For example, Netherton produced boilers. Darlaston made nuts and bolts, Willenhall locks and keys. And naturally, we had some very highly skilled crafts like anvils and vices and, of course, chain. Chain is one of the highly skilled industries and has been for hundreds of years. Women made chain in a small way at home in their backyard shops, and men, of course, made some magnificent jobs. I recall a hearing of the chain that was made for the Titanic and many important uses of chain, and on the other hand, I used to know a man who made a lovely piece of chain for Liverpool Cathedral. It was used to suspend the lights in that cathedral. Chain making, of course, is a highly specialized craft. Boys sometimes learnt the elements in the chain shops at home where their mothers made chain. Later, they went into the chain shops to make very big and important chain. And have no illusions about it. It is a job that calls for tremendous physical reserves. Chain makers, of course, in the past were a race of people entirely on their own. They had a reputation for drinking a fair amount of beer, but of course it was a heavy industry and they sweated and they always contended. They replaced the salt back in the system by the beer they consumed. They started to work very early in the morning, and because of the strenuous nature of the heavy chain making, they very often finished work at lunchtime. The most fascinating part of the industrial story of our black country is the canal system. It grew up with industry more than 150 years ago. Canals go north, south, east and west across the black country. They crisscross the black country. They carried coal from the mines, huge iron billets from foundries and the like, and they in turn carried away finished industrial goods. They were really an industrial highway, and they played a very important part. In a lighter vein, of course, they served other uses. Literally hundreds of black country youngsters have learned to swim in the canal, or the cut as we call it. After the canals, of course, came the railways. They competed for much of the trade of the canal. The canals gradually went into disuse. Railways, apart from carrying goods, made labour mobile, and they were able to take workers from one town to another, whereas formerly many people lived and worked in their own town. But the roads of the black country, higgledy-piggledy narrow roads, every road containing several factories, and of course it's difficult to get about the black country. Even a native has a difficulty in directing properly a stranger, or as we should say, a foreigner, where he wants to go. They are nothing but a complete muddle, and there's not much that we can do about it. The black country enjoys, as other areas, the so-called affluent society, and many workers today own motor cars. But as you walk round the Black Country or get round the Black Country, you realise that even whilst the worst of the slum clearance areas have been dealt with, there is still a tremendous leeway, and we shall indeed be many years before we master the problems of housing and crowded conditions in some parts of the Black Country. A feature of the Black Country is the way houses and industry have developed together. Many streets have three or four factories. Here and there you see the wide entry, and the wide entry meant that there was a small factory at the back of the houses. Many of the industries have been amalgamated and improved and modernized, but on the other hand, we still have a lot of industry that calls for reorganization. One feature of the Black Country, of course, is the coming of nonconformists, and believe me, they did a tremendous amount of good. It ought to be remembered that there was no popular education till 1870, and in consequence, the chapels of the Black Country not only dealt with spiritual matters, but they very often taught ordinary people, men, women, to read and write. Now, that in turn, of course, awakened a social conscience, and it's quite true to avert that the nonconformists sponsored the movements for the trade unions and even the early Labour Party.
You might have wondered why we are called a ragged school. It is because children nearly 100 years ago were the children of poor parents who hadn't money to buy new clothes as they have today. And so they had the name ragged because of their ragged clothes. People who lived in this small village of Two Gates, some of them would be your grandparents, used to worship on a piece of land just up the way here. And then one of them said they ought to have a school wherein they could worship God in more comfort. So a man said, there's a piece of land down the road, and so these people, they got their barrows and their dubbins, and they went to the brickyards down the way and asked those who owned the brickyards if they would give them some bricks because they wanted to build a school. They gladly gave them the bricks and they wheeled them up here, up those two big hills, and finally they erected this school. Children have worshipped here all those years and still continue to worship here one supreme purpose, and that is to worship God. And so you children have this great heritage handed down to you by your grandparents, a heritage of which I am sure you are all very, very proud.
Thank you.
We have a thousand and one stories that illustrate the black country humour, but the one that I like best of all concerns the vicar. He was indeed a brilliant and a powerful preacher. He liked a drop of something to drink, but nobody ever complained. Most folks would say, well, if he did not drink whiskey, he dipped his biscuits in. But he got a parishioner called Old Joe, and Old Joe was critically ill. So they send for the vicar. And the vicar did all those things that vicars do when a man is going from this world to the next. And when he'd finished, he said to Old Joe, now, is there anything more I can do? Can I write a few letters? Don't be afraid, anything, nothing too much for me. No, Joe said. And then as an afterthought, he said, well, vicar, thank you kindly, but would you please read me the 23rd Psalm? Delighted, my good man, delighted, said the vicar, and he proceeded to read the 23rd Psalm. You know it, the Lord is my shepherd, and so on. And when he finished, Joe said, thank you, vicar. But vicar, will you please read it again? Certainly. So he read it again. And when he finished, Joe said, vicar, you're a busy man. I ought not to impose. But would you please read it again? So the vicar thought he ought to make a few inquiries. Is this some special psalm that your mother taught you, learned in some Sunday school? Oh, no, vicar, said Joe. It would not have mattered much really what you read, but your breath does smell lovely. The men of the Black Country always enjoyed their beer. In Lorrain, 1866, when we had less than 7,000 people, we had as many as 53 pubs, and even then wives brewed beer at home. But of course, anvil making, puddling, chainsmiths, all heavy industry, develops a thirst. Men gambled. They'd gamble on any pretext. You had, of course, pigeons, prize fighting, duck fighting, cock fighting, bull baiting, all these were crude and cruel sports. But it was the pigeons and the whippets that held the field for betting. The whippet was very often the most important member of a man's family and must have eggs and sherry and pork chops. On the other hand, the children had to make do with dip in the pan. The Black Country man, of course, has always loved his dog. He had terriers for ratting, the Staffordshire Bull Terrier for fighting, and of course the Whippet for racing. Miners in particular were keenly interested in Whippet racing, and although it did go out of existence largely, it has come back of recent days, and there is a very thriving Whippet club. It's fascinating to see these people with the Whippets. The Whippet today is a pet in the house, loved and cared for, and the people who handle the Whippets do most of the things for themselves, and they certainly treat it and enjoy it as a sport. But they still work hard in many ways, just as they did 30 years ago. You see, there was at one time a lot of small men in the Black Country. Many men started their own businesses simply because they were very good skilled men in their own trade. They acquired a shop, they worked longer hours than normal, They drew less than standard wages, and in consequence they accumulated a capital and developed a business. And as I walk round the Black Country, I can think of this and that and the other firm that started in precisely that way, and yet today are household words and known throughout the world. Black Country, of course, is a place where we get a lot of independence of character and strong-willed men. On the other hand, we did find that many employers worked alongside people they knew, and they were on Christian name terms, and very often if a worker got into a little trouble, perhaps needed some extra money for a funeral or something like that, he'd go to his boss and say, well, what about it, Gaffer? How much do you want, Joe? And he'd lend him a £5 or a £10 note to be repaid half a crown a week until the debt was cleared. The women in the Black Country have been always as important as the men, apart from the fact that they've run a home and they've been ideal mothers generally. Apart from the normal running of a home, they've baked bread, looked after pigs in the garden, done the washing and shopping, and turned then in the evenings and afternoons to make nails and chain. Now from that, of course, they've took a responsible part. We find them in very heavy industry, in the fireclay industry, and in the nut and bolt industry, doing quite important and responsible work. Now, it's traditional for the Black Country woman to work. Her part in the development of Black Country industry is important, and as far as I can see, it is likely of remaining so. She's skilled above the average, and I doubt if there's women in any other part of England that work so skillfully and so hard as the average Black Country woman. The dominating element in the life of the Black Country has always been work. Heavy, hard, laborious, soul-searing and sometimes degrading work. Men and women have shared it over the years. But although they worked hard, the people often found time to do something for the Lord. This church, for example, known as Bethel Chapel Lie. My family have been associated from the beginnings. My grandmother, Jane Perrins, and a woman named Martha Westwood dressed the bricks, mixed the mortar for the original building, and my dad is supposed to have sold pigs to buy timber in order to make forms for children to sit on. Other members did work. Some painted and decorated, some put in windows, some installed the gas. And this sort of story can be repeated 1,000 times in Methodism across the Black Country. People hadn't money to give, so they gave their labour. The honest people of the Black Country, maybe they do not now come to church and chapel as they did, but they're a honest, God-fearing people. And personally, I would be sorry to see the individual elements of the Black Country and the chief characteristics of these smaller districts lost in one soulless city.